गुड आफ्टरनून ऑल। प्लीज चेक वेदर आई एम ऑडिबल। सगळ्यांना आवाज ऐकू येते का? मी काय बोलते ते एनीबडी? सिमरन ऐकू येते मी काय बोलतो आहे? ओके गुड। सो वी हॅव टू कंटिन्यू आवर लेक्चर। जस्ट अ मिनट, होल्ड ऑन, we will try to adjust it with the what is there on your screen. Can you see my presentation? Anyone reply? Is it, what is there on the screen? Who will tell me? Maxwell's equation, very good. Okay, I think still 2 to 3 students are being added. Shall we wait or continue? Now presently there are 9 students. Okay, let us wait for 1 minute. Hope that all of you people have worked the basic vector theory that we had started in last lecture. So as for the last week working that we have done, we will continue. If there is anything or any problem or issue in the continuation of this lecture, you just can post or you can type something in the chat box. Okay, so friends, let us start with the basic structure of this subject. That is, we'll have to start with Maxwell's equation from our today's work. So before starting with the Maxwell's equation, as all of we people are knowing that Maxwell's equations are related to learning of the electromagnetic waves, which are consisting of two parameters. One is of electric field, another is of magnetic field. So the combination of electrical and magnetic fields together will constitute electromagnetic waves. And here we have to remind that every electromagnetic wave is consisting of electric field as well as magnetic field. We also have to remember that electric field and magnetic field are perpendicular to each other. For example, if suppose electric field is in vertical direction, magnetic field is in horizontal direction, then the direction of electromagnetic wave will be perpendicular to the direction of electric field as well as perpendicular to the direction of magnetic field. For example, if suppose electric field is along x-axis, magnetic field is along y-axis, then the electromagnetic wave will be along the z-axis direction. Briefly, we can say that each and every component of electromagnetic wave is consisting of or is comprising of electric and magnetic field vectors. I would like to remind once again, electric field and magnetic field are nothing but the vectors. That is, along with possessing magnitude, these fields are also having their directions. So electric and magnetic field comprising together will be forming the electromagnetic waves. Now, if suppose there is any confusion, I will start with the presentation. If there is any doubt or problem, you can share it in the chat box. You can unmute your mic and you can tell me. I think few students are getting added, few are getting out of the meeting, and again they are being added. I think lunch is over to all of you people, and therefore these type of problems are there, or it is the general practice. Okay, whatever it is, let us start with our presentation. So here, in case of Maxwell's equation, we had seen from last lecture that was nothing but the divergence theorem and Stokes' theorem. We had also seen that whenever we have to consider magnetic field, we have to be aware with two basic laws. First law is a divergence theorem, and second law is Stokes' theorem. If suppose you are finding it easier to understand Stokes' theorem first and divergence theorem next, then also it will be similar, or there will not be any problem. That is, for example, if suppose few students are thinking that single line integral is converted into double integral, and in case of divergence theorem, double integral is converted into triple integral, that for type of simplicity also can be obtained. For example, in case of Stokes' theorem, we know that a line integral can be converted into surface integral by taking the curl of given vector field. We also had defined the curl is nothing but the determinant, which is consisting of first row as unit vectors, second row as derivative terms, that is d by dx, d by dy, and d by dz, and third row will be consisting of individual vector components along x, y, and z axis. That is, as seen on the screen, we can remember that f bar dot dr bar, though there is bar is not possible to be visualized, we can read it like this: integral or closed loop integral or closed loop single integral of f bar dot dr bar is equivalent to the double integral of the same vector by taking its curl, where double integral is nothing but the surface integral. And according to the divergence theorem, we had defined a divergence theorem like the surface integral can be converted into volume integral by taking the divergence. DIV is indicating the divergence of a given field, where divergence is nothing but if suppose PI plus QJ plus RK is any vector, we can write the divergence of that vector equivalent to the d by dx of coefficient of I, d by dy of coefficient of J, and d by dz of coefficient of K. That is nothing but the divergence theorem that we had seen in the previous lecture. It was just a revision of previous lecture. Now, in our today's lecture, we will continue that how these type of equations can be used in further analysis. So here, I would like to continue with our next example. So you all are welcome. I think approximately all the students are present in the class, and now we'll try to understand the new parameters, or we will try to complete the vector theory by a short review. So all of you people are knowing unit vector. I think overall screen is visible to all. If suppose we are writing any vector, that is nothing but 3ax bar plus 4ay bar plus 5az bar, then AB cap or unit vector along AB direction can be defined as 3ax bar plus 4ay bar plus 5az bar divided by root 50. Now somebody will tell me how or from where this root 50 is coming into existence. Who will tell me? Yes, who will tell me? Can somebody post in the chat box from where this Route 50 is coming into existence? I think let us ask to Priyanka. Priyanka Jeore will tell us. 3, 4, 5. Okay. Priyanka, can you unmute your mic and tell us?
सर 3, 4, 5 स्क्वायर किलो। हेलो,
I think she is not audible to us.
हाँ
Is it Priyanka audible to all? Okay. So here all of we people are knowing that. Okay, Priyanka. So we know that to calculate the effective value or to write more effectively, here I will write unit factor along will be unit vector along AB bar is nothing but considering the square of 3, square of 4, square of 5 and its root will be giving us the unit vector. In last lecture also we had seen how to consider the unit vector. I had also given some examples to you all. So after consideration of this unit vector field, we can consider that if suppose dot product of any two vector is to be calculated, what we do? We for a dot product of any two vectors, we know that if suppose AB is equal to 3AX bar plus 4AY bar plus 5AZ bar as above, and let us consider that CD is equal to 2AX bar minus 3AY bar minus 6AZ bar. Dot product was given as AB dot CD, that is vector AB bar dot vector CD bar was equivalent to the multiplication of their individual magnitudes and addition of all, that is 3 multiplied by 2 plus 4 multiplied by minus 3 and 5 multiplied by minus 6 will be giving us value 3 into 2 6, 4 into 3 minus 12 and 5 into 6 minus 30. So totally it will be minus 36, can be considered as the dot product of overall value. In the same way, cross product also can be defined as, or it is also called as a vector product, that can be understood by if suppose same vectors are considered AB cross CD or AB bar cross CD bar, we can write AX bar into 4 multiplied by minus 6 minus 5 multiplied by minus 3, it will be minus or minus plus 15. Central or middle variable is to be taken with negative sign, therefore we will be writing minus AY bar into 3 into minus 6 minus 18 minus 5 into 2 will be minus 10 and AZ bar plus AZ bar into 3 into minus 3 minus 9 and 4 into 2 it will be 8. Totally it will be giving us the vector 9AX bar or minus 9AX bar minus 28AY bar plus or minus 17AZ bar. In the same way, if suppose we have to calculate the scalar triple product, here we will consider AB bar as one vector, CD bar as second vector, and EF bar can be considered to be a third vector. In that case, scalar triple product, I think all of these students are knowing that it can be written as EB bar dot CD bar cross EF bar, or it is also written in the box. I think now I am audible. Please check once again. Vaishnavi, reply please. Okay. Sorry for the interruption. Let us continue once again. I think screen is visible to all. Once again, we will try to concentrate on the dot product is nothing but the multiplication of magnitude of individual unit vectors. That is, AX bar component will be multiplied by AX of second vector. AY bar component of first vector will be multiplied by AY bar component of second vector. And AZ bar component of first vector will be multiplied by AZ bar component of the second vector. Here we will note that a dot product is nothing but a scalar value. It is not having any direction, but in case of cross product or vector product, which is nothing but determinant of AX bar, AY bar and AZ bar, components of AX bar, component of AB bar and component of CD bar, a determinant multiplication will be providing us with a vector. Therefore, we can say that dot product will be resulting into a scalar value but cross product will be resulting into a vector value. In the same way, if suppose we have to calculate this scalar triple product, we can multiply AB, CD and EF totally together with the help of determinant. And if it is possible, you can also calculate here, or after this lecture, you can try to understand how we can continue or how we can complete this multiplication. And therefore, three different type of vector products are there in front of us: dot product, cross product and box product, or it is also called as scalar triple product. So considering the same or all the previous parameter, let us try to continue with the next screen. I think this presentation will be also can be shared on your WhatsApp group, or the video will be also available on the AGPIT e-learning channel, as well as it will be present on the Google Classroom. Many of the students have joined the Google Classroom, and also remaining all can join the Google Classroom so that you can access with the previous lecture material for all subjects. Few subjects have provided the links, and few subjects are yet in the process, but each and every of the previous lecture can be heard or can be learned by every student of you people. But the live attendance also is the most important factors in which you can ask any doubts or queries which can be made clear instantaneously. So here, let us concentrate on the next part, that is nothing but the first equation of our electromagnetic routine that can be observed here. Is nothing but the Faraday's law. Now we have to start with the electromagnetic induction concept by introducing with the Faraday's law. Friends, though you have completed diploma or 12th standard, all the students will be knowing Faraday's laws of electromagnetic induction through physics or through a basic electronics. You might have learned this concept. So what do you mean by Faraday's law? Whenever magnetic flux associated with any coil changes, an EMF is induced in the coil. If suppose a coil is consisting of a magnetic strength, suppose it is consisting of a magnetic strength of suppose 30 Weber, and after some time, what is happening? Its value is changing from 30 Weber to 20 Weber, or suppose from 30 Weber to 40 Weber. Under that cases, we can observe that magnetic field associated with the coil is changing. The reason may be different. It will be due to change in the magnetic field environment, or it will be also due to the electrical parameters variations, or n number of reasons. But let us here concentrate on the change in the magnetic field. The Faraday's first law is saying, or is giving the information, that whenever magnetic flux associated with the coil changes, an EMF is induced in the coil. Second law is describing the information that, or second law is giving the in-depth information, or giving the more precise information regarding the first law. It is saying that whenever magnetic flux associated with the coil is changing, definitely EMF is induced, but the rate of change of magnetic flux is directly proportional to the EMF induced in it. Or in the opposite direction, we can say that the magnitude of EMF or electromotive force developed is directly proportional to the rate of change of magnetic flux. At the bottom, we also have written one equation in which suppose that phi is the flux associated and time is denoted by t, or change in the time is considered as a dt. We can say that whenever magnetic flux associated with the coil is changing, if suppose d phi by dt is a higher value, definitely EMF value will be a larger one. If suppose d phi by dt is a smaller value, EMF induced also will be a smaller one. Therefore, the rate of change of magnetic flux is directly proportional to the EMF induced. Therefore, we have to remember that whenever magnetic flux associated with the coil changes, with a small change in the magnetic flux, there will be a small EMF developed. Whenever there is a huge or a higher level of change observed, there will be a higher level of magnetic flux change will be contributing to higher level of EMF induced. There is one more law that is on in front of you or on the screen that we can observe. That is nothing but Lenz law. Lenz law states that the EMF induced is in such a direction which opposes the field that produces it. EMF which is produced is opposing the field due to which it is produced. Therefore, the EMF induced will be opposing the reason behind the development of the EMF. Okay, so these three laws can be presented in one equation, that is here EMF induced is equal to minus N d phi by dt. Now, by observing at the diagram here, can anybody tell me what is the value of N? What is N indicating? Please, somebody type in the chat box so that we can also check the connectivity and also we can check whether all the students are present in the class or they have just muted their mic and they have kept the mobile aside. Who will tell me what is the value of N? What is the N indicating? Let us ask Sarita. Is it there, Sarita? Sarita, tell us, Sarita Jangam Shetty. Yes, what will be the N indicating? North Pole and South Pole, no. Okay, forget it. Let us consider, I think approximately half of the students are there at least attending the lectures sincerely. So let us here consider that N is nothing but the turns of the coils. If suppose there is one coil, the EMF developed will be smaller. If suppose there are 2, 3, 4, 5 number of turns of the coil, EMF induced will be definitely higher. The N is indicating the number of turns of the coil. If suppose we are having a coil of only suppose 4 number of turns, though it is shown in zigzag, I think each and every student of the class is matured enough that instead of this zigzag style, we can also keep the coil in the circular loop position and along the axis of the coil magnet can be turned like this so that maximum EMF developed can be checked. Yes, it is nothing but the number of turns of coil. So here if there is a change in magnetic field, EMF is induced in the coil. And if suppose there is a EMF induced coil in the coil, again magnetic flux associated will be changing. So these are the basics, or these are the, or this first slide can be considered to be the revision of your previous knowledge. Faraday's law is studied by each and every student in the class, and just we have revised it through three sets of equation. When a magnetic flux associated with the coil changes and EMF is induced in the coil, the rate of change of magnetic flux and the EMF induced are proportional to each other. That is, smaller the change in magnetic flux, smaller EMF will be developed. A higher level of change in magnetic flux, higher level of EMF will be induced. In the same way, the Lenz law states that the EMF developed will be in the opposite direction. This direction can be indicated here by minus sign, that can be seen by everyone. That minus sign is indicating that the direction of EMF developed will be in the opposite direction of the magnetic field which produces it. That is, both will be opposing to each other. To continue with the next equation, or to continue with the next part, we have to proceed further, and we'll try to concentrate one more equation that we had seen previously. That is, Gauss law is known to everyone. It is, Gauss law states that if suppose there is any charged conductor, this violet colored conductor is suppose is of any shape, it is intentionally drawn with any shape that can be observed here, that if suppose there is any shape type of surface is present with us, then over a closed surface, only condition is that it should be a closed surface, similar to a metal ball we can consider, or similar to a cylinder, or similar to a box. That is, if suppose we are having a closed surface of any shape with any number of charges situated in any position or in any direction inside it, the total normal electric induction TNEI, that is shown by E bar, the diagram that we can see here, total normal electric induction will be equal to the number of charges situated inside it. For example, all the students of the class are there in the classroom of third year along with me in the classroom. Then if suppose we have to find the weight of the classroom, then what will be the equivalent value to the weight of the classroom? The weight of the classroom will be equal to the weights of the benches plus weights of the students plus the weight of me plus weight of your bags plus weight of your mobile phones and weight of the board and weight of the walls. All together will be contributing to the total weight of the classroom. In a similar way, Gauss stated a law which he also derived, or which he also proved, that if suppose there is a charged conductor which is spreading out the radiation in all possible direction, what will be the total normal electric induction coming out? The total normal electric induction, normal is nothing but perpendicular, the total normal electric induction, that is the number of electric waves coming out of the surface, are depending on the values of charges situated inside it. A simple example can be given here. If suppose we are going to a fair, eka jatret apan gelela ahot kuto tari, ani tya jatre madhe apan kiti kharcha karnar he kashavar dependent asel, aplya khishamade kiti paise astil tyachavar, barobar ki nahi? माझ्या खिशात 10 रुपये आहेत, मी सगळ्या ठिकाणी जाऊन काहीतरी काही ना काहीतरी शॉपिंग करेन का? नॉट पॉसिबल. बट इफ सपोज आय हॅव 10,000 रुपीज इन माय वॅलेट, व्हॉट विल हॅपन? आय कॅन गो टू एव्हरी शॉप, आय कॅन परचेस अबाउट ईच अँड एव्हरीथिंग इन द फेअर, अँड आय कॅन एन्जॉय द फेअर. इन द सिमिलर वे, द टोटल नॉर्मल इलेक्ट्रिक इंडक्शन ऑर द इन्फ्लुएन्स दॅट इज प्रेझेंट, it is dependent on the inside parameter, similar to the proverb or the stories with the moral that we read. How much knowledge we can give out, the knowledge contained which is inside us, that only will be equivalent to be given out. If I am not having any knowledge content inside me, it will not be possible for me to teach others effectively. Therefore, Gauss theorem here is indicating that the total normal electric induction, as per the law, is indicating it will be equivalent to the number of charges situated inside it. So what we are trying to understand, we are trying to revise with the basics of electromagnetic field. I think we'll stop this lecture at about 2:20 or 2:25. Will it be convenient? I think one more lecture is to be continued by Jirge sir. Is there any issue for continuing with the next 10 minutes? If there is something or problem, you can post in the chat box. Because today we are continuing with the most important basic of our subject. I think nobody is typing. Therefore, I think no one is having any issue. Okay, thank you, Aditi. So first law that we had seen is Faraday's law. Second law is nothing but Gauss law. Third law is nothing but Ampere's law. Ampere was one of the scientists who stated an equation that similar to Gauss law, he expressed that the line integral of a magnetic field intensity, here magnetic field intensity is described by H bar. The line integral or the closed loop line integral of the magnetic field intensity is equivalent to the current produced through the coil. How much is the maximum magnetic field? That much value of current will be developed in the coil. Can be described by the scientist Ampere. Therefore, this can also be considered one equation, integration or single integral H bar dot dl bar is equal to I. If magnetic field intensity is higher, current developed will be higher. If magnetic field intensity of lower value, current developed also will be of lower value. Okay, and one more equation, that then there are totally four sets of equation. This can be observed to be a last equation that we have to understand. Here we can see that the surface integral, definitely if there is surface integral, we can write with a double integral sign, a surface integral of a current density can be described as, or it is equivalent to the total charge situated inside the surface. Here we can see that if suppose magnetic flux lines are developed inside the any surface, that is shown with the green color, we can remember that the surface integral of current density is equivalent to the total charge situated inside it. Okay, so some of you people may be thinking that sir had defined the name of chapter as Maxwell's equation, but there is no any equation of Maxwell's that was discussed. One equation was called as continuity equation, one equation was called as Ampere's law, one equation is here Gauss law, and one equation is here Faraday's law. So friends, the most important factor that we have to remember is that the consideration of all these four sets of equation are nothing but Maxwell's equation. Maxwell found that the behavior of any electromagnetic wave of any type will be satisfying these equation. They will be satisfying the Faraday's laws of electromagnetic equation. Electromagnetic waves will be satisfying the Gauss laws. Electromagnetic waves will be satisfying the Ampere's law. These continuity equation also will be satisfied by electromagnetic wave. That is, for any electromagnetic wave, if suppose it is satisfying all these four sets of equation, we can say that the equation can be considered to be the equation can be considered to be satisfying the all four sets of equation, can be considered as satisfying the Maxwell's equation. Maxwell didn't have expressed any law of him for electromagnetism, but he have collected the four important equations which are describing the behavior of electromagnetic waves in a complete nature. So here we can see that for satisfying all type of equation, Faraday's laws, Gauss law, Ampere's law and continuity equation, these four sets of equation have expressed as the equation which are very essential for consideration of Maxwell's equation. If suppose we are taking any wave and the wave is satisfying all four sets of these equations, we can say that these waves are satisfying Maxwell's equation and therefore can be considered as electromagnetic waves. If suppose the waves are satisfying any three equations and they are not satisfying one equation, it is not probably possible to declare that it will be a electromagnetic wave. Also here we can see that Maxwell have done a very good job in or by classifying the equation or relating the two domains of the equation. That is, if we'll observe carefully, I will try to explain this slide once again, that if suppose we have to understand EMF induced, the content which is made bold here, that we can see on the screen, that if suppose we have to relate magnetic field with electric field, we can use Faraday's laws. Or now, or from today onwards, instead of saying these equations as Faraday's laws, Ampere's law, continuity equation, Gauss law, we'll call the total set as the Maxwell's equation. So what Maxwell did? Maxwell did a very good or wonderful job of connecting two different domains together. For example, all of we people are knowing that EMF is nothing but electrical parameter, and everybody is knowing that d phi by dt is nothing but the change in magnetic flux, where phi is nothing but the magnetic flux in magnetic domain. Previously we have learned electric field as a different and magnetic field as a different, but the study of these two together can be done very effectively with the help of Maxwell's equation. Also here, in case of Ampere's law, we can observe that here H bar is nothing but magnetic field strength or magnetic field intensity. And what is this I? Once again, I would like to get it by students. Who will tell me what is this I? Type in the chat box, anybody. What is I? I is nothing but the current value. So therefore, H bar dot dl bar is equal to I. Instead of going into the in-depth of mathematics, we'll try to understand that Maxwell have defined a relation, or Maxwell have collected together the relations for converting electric parameters into magnetic and magnetic parameters into electric. By using these all equations, we can write the suitable or the necessary equation. Also here we can see that in case of continuity equation, J bar. Now what is this J bar? J bar is nothing but the current density. It is the parameter related to current or electric field. Here we can describe that D equivalent to the electric field density. So these two domains are relating two parameters of electrical domain. It is similar in case of Gauss law also. If there are electrical charges Q1, Q2, Q3, the total normal electric induction can be expressed with the help of these equations. That is, the whole set of Maxwell's equation can be considered to be the combination of the or the formulas which can be used together so as to learn the behavior of electromagnetic waves effectively. In a more simpler way, that we will consider the example of suppose current and voltage. All of we people are knowing that current and voltage are related to each other, because if suppose we will decrease the value of voltage, the value of current also will decrease. If we will increase the value of voltage, the value of current also will be increasing. It was the simple concept related to current and voltage. In the same way, here by consideration of Maxwell's equation, we have to associate, we have to link electric domain with the magnetic domain, because both are related to each other. All of you people are knowing that whenever there is a change in the current flowing through a coil, every person can see their ceiling, and we can observe that there is a fan, and fan is revolving with its blade at a particular speed. Why it is revolving? Because it is supplied with a particular value of current, and that current is changing the magnetic field of the central unit of the fan. Therefore, the current is changing, or the electrical domain is changing to a magnetic domain. In the same way, considering the Faraday's law, we are knowing that whenever field related to whenever there is magnetic flux associated with the coil is changing, and EMF is developed in the coil. By consideration of both parameters, we can understand that electrical fields can be converted into magnetic field, or magnetic field parameters can be converted into electrical field using these four sets of equation. That was nothing but Faraday's law, that was nothing but Gauss law, Ampere's law, and continuity equation. We will use these equations for a number of time for solving a number of examples also. So considering the main or the basic parameter, as the equations are described here, in case of some equation is are described with the help of integrals, double integrals, and triple integrals, these equations can be also represented in a differential or in the derivative form. The four sets of equation can be expressed together, which are called as Maxwell's equation. That will be our part to be continued tomorrow. In our tomorrow's lecture, we will express the Maxwell's equation effectively by expressing it in the list format. We'll convert these equation from integral form into point form or differential form, and again we can convert these equation from the differential form into integral form. The two forms of equations can be represented and can be used as required for understanding the concept of electromagnetism more effectively. So it was a somewhat lengthy lecture with a new and I think somewhat critical or somewhat difficult type of content for a few peoples, but it can be considered as the most important basics of our subject. So just try to remember, Maxwell was a scientist who collected four sets of important equations together to form Maxwell's equation. Maxwell's equations are able to understand the behavior of electromagnetic waves in a more effective manner, or as per the required parameter to be calculated, Maxwell's equation can be used for a number of times. So try to understand these four sets of equation. Again, I would like to turn your attention to previous lecture equations, that is nothing but divergence and Stokes theorem, which are very, very important for our next lecture, because to convert four sets of Maxwell's equation, we will have to convert integral form into differential form, and from differential form into integral form. These two sets of equations will be very much important and will be essential. We'll try to complete it in the next lecture. So if there are any doubts, or if any issues, you can post in the chat box, or you can also tell us in the WhatsApp group, so that next lecture will be more effective or more precise. If there is nothing, we'll stop here, and from the next lecture we'll continue with the further part of Maxwell's equation. Okay, is there any doubt or problem you can post here? Okay, have a break of 5 minutes. Next lecture will be starting at 2:30 p.m. Thank you.